Welcome to the Lily Show. I've been learning about Harriet Tubman at school, and I decided I wanted to learn more about her. So we are at the Harriet Tubman home in Auburn, New York. Come join me as we learn more about Harriet Tubman. Many people know Harriet Tubman as the person who freed slaves on the Underground Railroad. She lived a life as a service her whole life, including creating an old folks' home that you see behind me. Join me in the museum and hear the entire presentation about her life from our new friend, Mr. Paul.
Serious note, I will be using two terms interchangeably, and those two terms are slaves and enslaved. And the reason I do that is because no matter what you've heard, no one is born a slave. Everyone is born free. And then they are enslaved by the people or society in which they live. Last but certainly not least, it's almost impossible for me to give you a thorough history of Harriet's 90 plus years in 25 minutes. What I'm gonna do is use the bottom half of this timeline, go through some of the events on the timeline. And after that, I'll take you through the house. In the process of going through the timeline, it is my hope that I will answer 99.9% of your questions. But if by chance there's still something burning in your heart, I'll address those questions at the end of the orientation. I'll be ready. All right. Harriet was born around 1822 in a little place called Poplar Neck, Maryland, but she was raised in a place called Bucktown, Maryland, which was in the city of Cambridge, over near the eastern shore of Maryland, near the Chesapeake Bay Area. When she was born, she was one of nine children, born to Harriet Green and Benjamin Ross. Her name at birth was not Harriet as we know it today. Her name at birth was Araminta, but they called her Minty for short. When she was very young, there were some things about her life she liked and some things she didn't like. One of the things she did not like was the fact that young children, sometimes as early as age 5 and 6, were hired off to other plantations to do work. And usually the treatment on those plantations was a lot worse than it was on their home plantation. Minty had been hired out on several occasions, and many times she was whipped so brutally that she ended up carrying scars on her back and neck for the rest of her life. She did enjoy being at the plantation with her family and friends and her mother and working on the plantation. And every now and then, her mother would allow her to watch the smaller children. So one night, she was watching one of her little brothers, and that joker would not go to sleep. So she found some fatback bacon. Y'all know what fatback is, don't you? Okay. Put it on the coals, allowed it to cook and cool. After it had cooked and cooled, she gave it to her brother to suck on like a pacifier. Eventually, he fell asleep. But when her mother came home, she was scared out of her wits because all she could see was this long piece of meat hanging out of her boy's mouth. She thought Araminta had pulled a boy's tongue out as he did. That was one of the funny things she remembers. When she was a teenager, there was an event where a slave had escaped off the plantation and had run away. The overseer was sent to bring him back, and they cornered him in a dry goods store there in Bucktown. And at the same time, Minty and others were headed to the same store. And when she got there, the overseer commanded that she help him tie the slave up so he could return him to the plantation. Of course, she didn't want to because she believed that everyone had a right to be free. But she was wise enough to know that if she didn't do this, she would probably be in trouble. So the story is that she was going to help him tie the slave up. Slave broke loose, jumped up, ran out of the building. The overseer picked up a 2-pound metal weight from one of the old-fashioned weighing machines about the size of a half of a brick and threw it at the slave. Missed the slave, but it hit Araminta in the head with such an impact that it cut off a small piece of the scarf she was wearing and embedded it in her skull, knocked her out. She was in a semi-coma for a couple of days, and after coming out of that coma with very little medical attention, they just put her right back into the field to work. The story is, sun was hot, scar opened back up, blood and sweat was running down her face as she did her work on the plantation. Created a problem for her that they used to call fainting spells and blackouts. But today they call it temporal lobe epilepsy. This simply meant that from time to time, she'd be going about her normal duties, blank out of consciousness, come back into consciousness later. Sometimes when she would blank out, she'd have epileptic seizures and start shaking. She had this for the rest of her life. And many people wonder, how in the world was she able to do all the things that she did on the Underground Railroad with such an injury as that? Well, we like to think she had divine intervention. Of course, she said it was during these moments when she had her blackout spells that she felt as though the Spirit of God was speaking directly to her spirit, giving her direction on where to go and when to go. Some say this may be one of the reasons why she was never captured or lost any of the passengers who traveled with her on the Underground Railroad. Well, at some point, as she got older, as many of us do, she fell in love. I don't know if you've ever been in love, but I will not ask for a show of hands today, all right? But she fell in love with a free black man, and his name was John Tubman, and eventually they were married. But just because they were married did not mean that she would automatically gain her freedom. It just simply meant that with her owner's permission, they could spend time together, but she would have to remain on the plantation to do her work. Also, her husband John, being a free man, could hire himself off to different plantations, do work, generate income. And so she believed that if she was given that same opportunity, that one day she would be in a position to purchase her own freedom. So she convinced the Broder's family to allow her to do work on other plantations. They did allow it. And the story is, when she first started doing this work on other plantations, rumor has it that she had a one-bladed plow. And she would take the harness and the straps from that plow, put them over her shoulder, and she would pull that plow up and down the field, dragging it behind her, making rows in the dirt for planting. Well, they say she was so good at what she did that eventually she was able to purchase 2 oxen, do more work on other plantations, generate more income. They say the Broder's family took $50 to $60 a year from her. Anything over and above that, they allowed her to keep, which probably wasn't a whole lot, but at some point she was in a position where she was ready to talk to Mr. Broder about purchasing her freedom. But she had been talking to her husband, John, about being free, and she was gonna be free one way or the other, of course. After she had married John, this is when she made a decision to change her name from Araminta to Harriet, after her mother. Some say she did it as a rites of passage. Now that she was grown and on her own, she could choose her own name. But her husband, John, was always trying to discourage her from running away to get her freedom because he knew how dangerous it could be if she was ever captured. So some have said he may have said things like this: "Harriet, you don't have to worry about being free, girl. I'm free. And that's enough for both of us." I'll let that marinate for a minute. All the ladies in the house, you can breathe. It'll be all right. Take another breath. She closed her eyes. Oh, no. And of course, Harriet did not like those arrangements. So they say that Harriet and her husband lived together from 1844 to 1849. Some say happily, some say otherwise. But in 1849, we believe that Harriet said, "Enough is enough." That's when she made her arrangements to make her escape. But before she made her escape, she decided that she wanted to talk to Mr. Broder about the possibility of buying her freedom. But before she could do that, Mr. Broder passed away. Therefore, her chances of buying her freedom just sort of went out the window. And of course, Harriet was not happy with that. Well, in 1849, she decided she was going to make her escape. And when she left with 2 of her brothers. But after they had been gone for several weeks, the brothers decided to go back to the plantation. And the reason why they decided to go back is because they still had family on the plantation, and they were concerned that if they did not return, the slave masters would abuse their family in order to get back at them. So they went back. Harriet Tubman continued northward until she reached the Philadelphia area, where she met such people as Lucretia Mott and William Steele. They were abolitionists in the Philadelphia area and helped her get established in a boarding house and also helped her to obtain a job as a laundress in a hotel there in Philly. Well, after she had been there for a little while, she made her decision to come back to get her family because she was not happy being free, knowing that her family was still enslaved. So, in 1850, she made her first rescue. And that happened because she found out that her niece and her niece's two children were about to be sold at a slave auction in Cambridge, Maryland. Harriet was up in arms about this, had to come back to help with this rescue, but before she could get back to Cambridge, they say that someone cautioned her about coming back to Cambridge because they believed that this auction was a setup by Mrs. Brodus to capture her. This brought back memories to Harriet because it helped her. She started remembering that when she was a little girl, somewhere around 7 years old, she saw three of her sisters sold to a southern slave chain gang and sent to the south. And the story is she never saw those three sisters again. So she was not going to allow this to continue happening in her family. So she made some arrangements with the husband of Kasiah, and his name was John Bowley. And John's task was to go down to this auction, bid on his wife and two children as if he was just a spectator in the audience. That way no one would know they were together. But he had to also make sure that when all the bidding was said and done, that he had the highest bid, no matter how high the bid was. So the bid started low. They got a little higher, a little higher. Final bid, John Bowley had the highest bid. But before the auctioneer could come and collect the money from him, those who were working with he and Harriet Tubman created some commotion and disturbance away from where the auctioneer was, where auction was going on. The auctioneer noticed the disturbance, put his business on hold, came to help with the commotion, got caught up in it, finally got things settled, went to lunch, came back to collect his money from John, but they were gone. They had already shuttled them out of the audience, excuse me, and they were on their way to meet Harriet. So the auctioneer missed out on that sale that day. Yes, that's just a personal thing. Again, that was 1850, and if you recall, 1850 was the same year that the Fugitive Slave Act was in force. And the Fugitive Slave Act simply said that if a slave had escaped from the South, made their way to the North, that the slave masters could send slave catchers and bounty hunters after them, capture them, take them back to the plantation, they would receive a reward for doing so. Well, they were making such good money at this that many times they would capture blacks who had been given their free papers. They would just tear the free papers up, take them to another plantation where white folks wanted to purchase slaves and receive an income for it. Because of that, it was no longer safe for them to stay in the North, even though in 1827, the state of New York had abolished slavery. Because this was a federal law, it overruled that. So now other arrangements have to be made. So the journey that she had been taking from Cambridge to Philly of about 150 miles now becomes extended to well over 450 miles. Most of it walking, because eventually she takes them out of the country. She ends up taking them to a place in Canada called St. Catharines. St. Catharines is about 25, 30 minutes north of Niagara Falls. But before she starts taking their family out, she made a decision to go back to get her husband. You remember her husband, don't you? But she went back to get John because John was a free man, and she believed that if she could take him to the North, then they could enjoy their freedom, and they could enjoy their marriage in real freedom. So she went back to get John, only to find out he had married someone else. He had met him a free black woman named Caroline, and they were now living together. Harriet wanted to get to the bottom of this. I know you're just shaking your head like, oh, gosh. Harriet wanted to get to the bottom of this, so she approached John about it. Some say he explained it like this. Look, Harriet, you've been gone for almost 2 years. Hadn't seen you, hadn't heard from you. Didn't know if you had been captured or killed. I met Caroline, we got married. Far as John was concerned, that settled it. Well, some say Harriet understood and still tried to convince him to bring himself and his new wife with her to the North so they could truly be free and enjoy their marriage together. John told her, nope, I'm happy where I am. I'm going to stay here in Maryland, but Caroline, you just leave us alone. Go on about your business, girl. And that's exactly what she did. She left him alone. Went on about her business. Well, in the process of working with the Underground Railroad, she met a number of people. Some of these people helped her out quite a bit. Some of them hindered her progress. But there was one person that she met, and it has a pretty familiar face, and some of you may know him. It was this fellow right here. His name was John Brown. You may remember the story of John Brown. He had planned the raid on the arsenal at Harper's Ferry. He had enlisted some slaves to help him with that. He had also met with Harriet at her home in St. Catharines to plan and discuss this raid because it was Harriet's intentions on being at Harper's Ferry when the raid happened. Of course, those of us who know the story know it did not go very well for John Brown. He was captured, those who were with him were captured, many of them were killed, two of his sons lost their life, and in December of 1859, John Brown was executed. Well, they say that Harriet was not there because she had taken sick. Some say she may have had one of her blackout spells, was unable to make it to Harper's Ferry. And I'm so glad she didn't make that journey, because all things being equal, she would have been captured and killed right along with everyone else. And then I would be out of a job. I'm just kidding. Well, of course, she also met other people. One of the persons that she met was a fellow by the name of William Seward. Some of us may know William Seward because he was a very well-known politician back in those days. But most of us remember William Seward because he's the man who made the arrangements for the United States to purchase the state of Alaska. Give her a hand over here. Though when it first happened, they did not think it was a very good purchase. Gave it a couple of nicknames like Seward's Folly and Seward's Icebox. But I just like to remind you that if you've lived in America for any length of time now, you do know that there are pipelines coming out of Alaska now. Oh, okay. All right. And someone even said, there was gold in them there hills. So it ended up being a very good purchase for the US of A. But I say all that to say, William Seward was the man who made the arrangements for Harriet Tubman to purchase the first 7 acres of land she has here. He sold her a 7-acre farm during a time when it was hard for white women to own property, let alone a black woman who was considered a fugitive. So some say he may have put his political career on the line, but he sold her a 7-acre farm, had a wood frame house on it, a barn, and several other outbuildings on it, sold it to her for $1,200, $25 down, and $10 a quarter until it was paid off. Eventually, she was able to pay it off with the help and assistance of some other people. What wasn't paid off, we understand the Seward family finally wrote it off. It was then that she brought her family out of Canada, settled them here in Auburn in 1859. And Harriet Tubman lived in the Auburn area for approximately 55 years of her life. Though she settled her family here, she did not stay in the area. She continued her work on the Underground Railroad. And after having a meeting with the governor of Massachusetts, she made a decision to help the troops in the South. So she became a civilian scout and spy for the Union Army. At some point, she was also a nurse, a cook, had established her own laundry business, taught other young ladies how to bind up the soldiers' wounds, how to take care of the uniforms, and how to prepare their meals. But what most of the people don't know about this part of Harriet's life is this. Harriet Tubman was the only woman of any color to ever lead a troop of men into battle during the Civil War. Harriet Tubman led a troop of several hundred men on several missions. The most noted mission was whenever she led Colonel James Montgomery and his colored troops across a river in South Carolina, where they went along the river destroying supply houses and ammunition depots of the Confederates. And in the process of doing so, they found that there was somewhere between 700 and 800 people who had been enslaved on these plantations. They loaded them on their steamboats, took them back across the river, and set them free. Also, it has been noted that of the men who served with her on the raid she led, none of them were killed on her raid. She was such a great warrior that many of the Union officers gave her the nickname General Tubman, because she was some kind of woman. You do remember her husband, though, don't you? Remember her husband, John? Okay. Well, John was in an argument with a white farmer in Maryland. They'd been arguing about some supplies. The argument became heated and it got out of hand. So they left each other. A couple of days later, they met on the road. The farmer asked John if he was still upset with him about those supplies. John told the farmer, "Yes, I am." The farmer turned, shot him, left him there to die. The only witness that was there was the young son of John Tubman, so the white farmer got away without being charged. But in 1869, there was a book written about Harriet. It was called Scenes in the Life of Harriet Tubman. It was written by Sarah Bradford. They say that Harriet Tubman actually dictated this book to Sarah. And then in 1886, there was a second book written by the same author with a different title. It was called Harriet, the Moses of her people. And of course, you know they called her Moses because of her ability to lead slaves out of slavery, the same way the biblical character is said to have led the Israelites from slavery to freedom. Well, the money from these two books was given to her to help pay off the property she had purchased from William Seward. The story is, she had created a small pig farm here on the property, had anywhere from 50 to 60 pigs on the property, so occasionally she would go through the community collecting garbage and scraps to feed her pigs. Some of us know it to be slops, okay? She would collect slops to feed her pigs, and one day, either by accident or on purpose, someone wasted poison in the slop she had collected. Yes, she brought it back, fed it to her pigs. Newspaper article said it killed over 40 of her pigs that day. Did not stop her. She continued to go off the farm for as long as she could. That same year, 1869, a young fella came to the area. And we believe that Harriet and this young fella may have met during the Civil War. But this young fella, y'all get the picture, okay? This young fella came to the area looking for work, found out that not only did Harriet Tubman live here, but that she was allowing people to board at her house. So he got him a room and became one of the boarders. And at some point, he must have become infatuated with this woman. You remember those days when you could be infatuated by someone, don't you? Oh, you don't? Okay, I'll leave it alone. I'll leave it alone. Well, we know he became infatuated with her because he fell in love with her. He proposed to her, and they were married March the 18th, 1869, here in the city of Auburn. The story is, and records show, that her second husband, Nelson Davis, was 20 to 22 years younger than Harriet was when she got married. Because Harriet had it going on, didn't she? And they lived together happily for about 19 years. Even though he was younger than she was, they had no children through the marriage. Nor did she have any children by her first husband, John, but she and her second husband did adopt a young girl named Gertrude and helped raise her. Harriet Tubman kept both of her husband's last name. Many of her county records and her grave sites say Harriet Tubman Davis. But we continue to call her Harriet Tubman here because that's how she was known while working with the Underground Railroad. Also while working with the Underground Railroad, she made approximately 13 trips over a 12-year period, freeing somewhere between 70 and 100 people by way of the Underground Railroad. Some of your earlier books have higher numbers, but your newer biographies are dealing with documented cases as opposed to hearsay cases. Well, tragedy struck her house in 1880. That was the year that her mother, Harriet, better known as Rit, died. It was also the same year that the wood-framed house that she purchased from William Seward burned to the ground. They say they had been boiling water around the house. A fire broke out, consumed the house. But her second husband, nephews, and brothers were brick masons who worked at a local brickyard. And so they built a brick house on the same foundation where the wood-framed house once stood. That house is still standing, and you'll see it later. And even though her husband was more than 20 years younger than she was, he actually died in 1888 from tuberculosis here on the property. Broke Harriet Tubman's heart, but she continued to go on the best that she could. Well, in 1896, about 8 years after her husband's death, she found out that this 25 acres of property were going up for sale at a land auction. And because she had a dream to open up a home for the elderly, she went down to bid on this 25 acres. Some say she may have been the only black person bidding on the property. So she stood in the back in the corner. But the way she said it was this: when I was at the auction, I felt like a blackberry in a pail of milk. As I look around, no, I won't do that one, okay. So they say that as the bids would go off, all she would say is 50. So the bids went off $800, $900, $1,000. From the back of the room, all she screamed is, 50, $1,100, 50, $1,200, $1,300, 50, $1,400. They say at $1,400, the bidding had ceased. Things were silent. Some say she may have been praying about it. But before the auctioneer could go through his process, $1,400 gone once, $1,400 gone twice, $1,400 from the back of the room, a voice said, $50! So she was able to get 25 acres of land for $1,450! And it was on this property that she established a home for the aged, which was the White House that you saw when you came on the property. Looked like this back then. She set it up to take care of those who were elderly, as well as anyone who needed a place to stay, because her brick house was being overrun with people looking for some place to go. And because she admired John Brown for his courage and willingness to work with the slaves, she named this building that was on the property after him. It was called the John Brown Hall, or the John Brown Infirmary. It was actually a small hospital-type building that she established on the back end of the property to take care of those who were elderly and needed assistance. So she had doctors and nurses come on the property, caretakers and ministers to help meet their physical and spiritual needs. The John Brown Hall was destroyed in 1949, and all we have left now are the foundations and the ruins of the building. But Syracuse University's Department of Anthropology has been doing archaeological digs here on the property since 1999. And during that time, they found well over 60,000 items associated with the life of Harriet. Some of those items are in display cases on the other side of the room. Others will go on display in the brick house when it's fully restored. Well, in 1903, she transferred the ownership of this 25 acres of property over to the A.M.E. Zion Church, or the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. Three times real fast. African, oh, y'all not gonna play. Okay, all right, I know I caught you off guard. The church then took over the remaining mortgage on the property, paid the property off, allowed the home for the aged and the hospital to stay open until the late 1930s. Harriet Tubman was probably the first African-American female to have an assisted living facility here in the area. Because she set that, and she set that up because here in the city of Auburn, there was a place where the elderly could go, and it was called the home. But during that time in history, they would not allow blacks to stay there. So Harriet Tubman set up a place on her property to take care of whosoever needed a space. And she was probably the first African-American female businesswoman because she had the home for the aged, the hospital, pig farm, vegetable garden, and a small apple orchard that she used to generate income until she was too old to do anything else. Harriet Tubman was a woman who started with so little, but she did so much. We live in a world today where people have so much, but they seem to do so little. I personally believe that Harriet was a woman who believed it was better to live for a cause rather than living just because. You know, because people want bigger houses, they want three cars in their one car garage, stuff like that. Harriet Tubman did have a cause that she fought for, and all of us who know anything about Harriet know that the cause that she fought for was the cause of freedom. Harriet Tubman died March the 10th, 1913, here on the property of pneumonia at the ripe young age of 91 to 92, which goes to remind us all, walking is still good for your health. Harriet Tubman is buried here in the city of Auburn at the Fort Hill Cemetery, and when she was buried with military honors.
Harriet Tubman's motto was keep going. When you're tired, keep going. When you're scared, keep going. If you want to taste freedom, keep going. Harriet Tubman passed away on March 10th, 1913. She is buried here in Auburn, New York. You should come visit. Thank you to Mr. Paul for a great presentation. Thank you to my friend Marin for helping me research. That's all for now. Thank you for joining me, and don't forget to subscribe. See you next time. Bye.